And I'm on 5. You're on 6. Go.
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
Okay. And then I said,
so
balls.
You don't have to... You have good microphone test. Oh, maybe it's good we don't see ourselves.
It's a lie.
Oh my God, what a fiasco. I can already tell.
Sexy.
I need some water. Look how long that took.
4 minutes. In the magic of television, 4 minutes.
Hey guys, welcome to the Moe and O show. This is a podcast for those of you who have stumbled upon it. And I have a fever blister, but you can't see it because it's behind this microphone.
Too much information shared and free for you.
That's like you go to a party. You're like, hey, I smell really bad, but I put on a lot of deodorant, man.
I put on baby powder.
You have no idea how much I stink under all this stuff.
Yes, actually, sir, we do. Yeah. You're only fooling yourself.
There's a great line by Jim Gaffigan. He's like, I have a friend who's like, you know, you don't need to wear deodorant. He's like, yeah, but you do.
That's funny. I love him.
Yeah. So we are a podcast that talks mostly photography, and we get yelled at if we talk about any other stuff. But yeah. I love when you say that we're going to talk about whatever we want because we don't care.
Whose name is on the show? Yeah. Is it angry communist guy? What is communist?
The Mo, yeah, angry communist. The Mo and O and angry commenter show.
That's what I meant to say. It's hot in here.
It's hot. This is a throwback to our first episode. Mm-hmm. I thought I'd raise the heat a little bit.
Is that lovely New Jersey weather where the temperature changes so quickly?
The negative of having an attic office is that you are at the mercy of attic temperatures.
Right.
So
when we used to record, did we used to turn the AC on, then cut it off before we started, or no?
So when we do summers up here, yeah, we have the AC is super quiet, so we'd have it on. And
okay, all right, because this is a warmer. My balls are like, hey guys,
hey, talk about too much information. My balls are behind this microphone.
They stick into my thighs.
Stop it! Visuals. All right, we're gonna now audibles. Let's get back to the intro, which is, hey, this is the, camera one or camera two?
One.
We're actually recording on two cameras because I have the Sony a7 III, but you were at the mercy at, you know what the world's worst connection is?
HDMI.
The micro HDMI. It just is so finicky and terrible. So right now I have a cable and we can't see ourselves as we're recording. So I actually am recording on the Fuji X-T2 as backup. And the Sony a7 III. So hopefully we have video here because we can't see ourselves. The life of not having a flip-up screen.
Speaking of flip-up screen, that goes to something we were talking about briefly, buying everything.
Oh, gosh.
And you thought for a purpose that buying the A6400 for us to record and have a permanent flip-up screen would be a good idea, and I need to go get one. On the other hand, I just thought about buying it.
Yeah.
For no reason whatsoever. Just to have it.
You were worse than me. Like, yeah. I had a justification.
Right. Your reasoning made sense. Mine's like, well, it's not in my box.
It's shiny.
I should have it. I should have that. I should have the Tamron 28-64.
28-75.
Wow, I'm just making all kinds
of
stuff.
Tamron, get on that.
You know? 28-64, because 78 is too tight. Yeah,
75. I did, believe it or not, have, and I don't know if you guys out there struggle with this, but there must be different levels of people who have, you know, very strict, you know, budgetary, you know, requirements for gear. They put money aside. They save up. As opposed to haphazard living on credit.
You mean the smart people?
Yeah, yeah.
Not the Uncle Mo's out there?
And, you know, I bet there's all kinds of struggles with that, is buying it because it is like a drug. You know, a lot of these things that we love in photography are toys. And think back to, you know, that the joy you got opening stuff up.
And the joy of being able to say, I have the newest toy. I have the greatest toy. Yeah. It's only the greatest until the next one comes out. Then I'm going to get that one.
It hurts when the next one comes out.
Especially when they do back-to-back in the same year. If they upgrade something, like they upgraded to, let's say they put out a new 35mm lens that you've been waiting for, that focal range between 35 and 50, something in there. And then somewhere down the line, someone else announced they have a 40 now. And you're like, well, maybe the 40 would have been better. Maybe I should go get the 40. So it's the thing. I have to learn myself. This is personally speaking about myself. I need to retrain. And I've just started that process of not looking at something and pressing buy it now.
Wow. So you're a little bit worse than I am. So
horrific.
I have a checklist And the Sony 6400 hit all our checklists. Mm-hmm. Number one, the record time on that camera is unlimited.
Right.
So what we currently have to do on this podcast is at 30 minutes, we have to either pause and restart recording again and sort of seamlessly mix it together, right? That's number one. Number two is you can plug it in. So you actually can just have it powered for, we could record continuously past the 30 minutes. That's two. And the third one, today. What happened today?
We couldn't see nothing.
We can't see ourselves. And it has to do with a little connector cable that either broke or is frayed or something.
It's like, I don't feel like playing with you guys. I'm going to do my own thing. Nothing.
So I justified it, unlike you. I put those three checks and was so about to hit the buy it now. And then the other side of me, all those YouTube videos I've seen where it's like, you don't need, you could rock it out. And so here I am trying to rock it out with what we have.
And that's what I've been telling myself lately, where I've gone close to a month without any crazy retail compulsion that I would regret later on. Like it's even so bad with me. You know how I feel about Fuji, right?
Yeah.
I mean, They're
you're fine. They're there.
They're a nice camera brand, but I've never had the urge to go out and buy one. But because two brand new ones were just announced, I'm thinking, I'm going to get the X-T30. Then I'm like, no, I'm not.
Yeah.
But I came so close to buying it.
Well, that was good of you that you said no.
And then I was going to buy it, but then I'm like, I have no lens for it. Why am I buying this?
It looks like this. You walk around.
Oh, look. It's so nice. I take pictures of my camera.
Yeah. So that's good that you're working on that. And I think stuff is something maybe we should start the podcast with.
The first thing you do in a hotel room is put away your stuff. I put some stuff here, I put some stuff there. You put your stuff over there, I'll put my stuff over here. Here's another place, put some stuff here. Here's another place over here. Hey, we got more places than we got stuff. We're going to have to buy more stuff.
Is the amount of stuff we have. First of all, where to put all your stuff?
Do you have too much stuff?
What is your stuff?
Stuff.
Do you sell stuff?
You should always sell stuff.
Yes.
And then you should sometimes give stuff away.
Yeah. So I saw this little Netflix special with this cute Japanese woman who's a designer who minimalizes your life. Have you seen this?
No.
She's like sold, her name escapes my mind, but she sold a bunch of books. She's super popular. And she comes to your house, kind of like the dog whisperer, and she sees your, she's like, shh.
I'm going
to
buy
she
that.
She does that to your stuff. Yeah. She's like, shh. But she comes to your house and she evaluates your stuff, and her philosophy is this: if you go through your garage, right, and you pick something up, if you haven't used it, you know, you're like, I have this lawn ornament that's been here for 4 years and we haven't put it out, you basically have to either throw it out or donate it. But before you do that, you thank it. That's her thing. She's like, you have to thank it.
I ain't thinking nothing. Get out of here with that.
Yeah, that was a little weird on the show. She actually come in and have everyone meditate so they could feel the house.
But she makes millions of dollars, so who am I to say?
Yeah, who are you over there hitting the buy now button over there?
Buy it now. It's bought.
So anyway, her philosophy, I've been thinking about stuff a lot, and I'm thinking about redoing the office, but I was about to redo it to get more storage. Mm.
But then you realize if you redo it, if you actually go through what you have here, you may already have the storage you need.
Exactly. Yeah. And part of the problem is, what am I storing? I'm storing things that I'm not using. And all these drawers that are behind us here, a lot of them have one thing out of 20 that I need, and I'm rummaging through my...
The garbage that has to be moved out of the way. And it's garbage for us, for you, but it could be a brand new tool for someone else coming up in the game.
Totally.
Or, you know, whether you give it to them or you sell it to them on eBay for $450 plus shipping. Nothing gets shipped for free at $450.
Yeah, bro. Play first class.
$0.50
ain't I'll send it nowhere. First class.
But at one stamp. Sir, it's not enough. Hey, it's all you get. One stamp.
Totally.
So, yeah, like, I mean, we were just talking about you have one of those old Yungyo 6...
The 622
was
triggers.
Was it 622 or
603? 603s.
The 603s. The 622s are still
I still
useful.
Have the 622s, but even those.
Yeah. I mean, the 603s, though. 603Ns or Cs if you're Canon and Nikon.
Yeah.
That, it was like, those were, that changed our life, though. Let's be honest, though.
That's why someone that is starting out
could use it.
Could use those.
Those took us to the beginning of off-camera flash, and our lives became, we were like, you know, We were the Zach Arias's of our own minds.
Oh my gosh. You know? Off-camera flash, if you haven't practiced or played with or tried, it just you just start having so much fun with it. But we should do, you know what we should do on the show? We should have like a garage sale.
You buy. Look,
you like, you nah. buy. We have 622s, hey.
We could bring all our stuff.
We ship first class.
One stamp.
Cheers.
Salut. So Omar is recovering from the flu, in case anyone doesn't know.
And, yeah, I got a lot of stuff in here. Today's theme.
Flemmy. Flemmy. So the way I look at it is you have to go through your stuff, right? Look at the stuff and put the timestamp that lady is using in your own window. Obviously, some things might have sentimental value. Who cares? Throw it out. No, I'm kidding. No, so you have to go through that window of, I haven't used this in this much time. That window is, it has to be your own window, but you can't be fliffy
yeah,
about it.
Yeah, you really have to be tough.
You have to be tough on yourself, because think about this. That stuff that you haven't used in 7 months, you could sell that and make some small profit towards something you can use. And if you get rid of 8 pieces to bring in 1 new piece, you still shelved it down.
I know.
And you still made space for what you need.
Absolutely. I think part of it is like the whole pain in the butt of selling stuff. Like the Craigslist, the Fuji Marketplace, the Facebook Marketplace. Right? It's a pain to sell one thing.
It is. Especially because I've sold so many things on Swappa, so many things on the market, Facebook market, so many things on eBay. And the one thing is, you could tell the person everything wrong with the product, and when they get it, they still say, this is wrong, that's wrong. And you're like, no, that's just the way that works. Yeah. So people are always trying to get over on you. People always, so like it goes back to, you know, where you're selling through. I have just like you were showing me your bins, I have 4 huge IKEA stack shelves with pocket bins, and each of those pocket bins I have to shuffle through all my
stuff. Oh, so you have stuff, the same thing.
You know, to get to my stuff that I need.
Exactly.
I feel like George Carlin.
Yeah.
That's all your house is. It's a place to keep your stuff while you go out and get more stuff.
Our conversation today has sparked in my head that I have to go through those bins and put 2 bins to be what I'm going to get rid of, what I'm going to donate, and what I'm going to keep. And if I keep it for 3 months and I don't use it, it has to move bins.
Yeah, there's like another. So here's her system is that. So one, it's like what gets trashed, because there's obviously trash in this office that can go. So a huge box for all trash. Second is donate or sell. And third is where, like what you are keeping, definitely. And then that's the job of where is it going to go in a space. And so like, let's talk about this space. I want to create a space where it's easy to make YouTube videos, but also like our podcast set. You saw how long it took to set this up, right?
4 minutes. 4 minutes. 4 minutes, son. That's what we're running with.
So how nice would it be like you came in and we just click a switch and we're ready to go? Everything I mean, I don't need right. to be, this to be a freaking TV studio, but running cables and friggin' batteries and all this crap.
No joke, though. It took us over 20 minutes to set up from beginning to end.
Which
and
when you think
and
about
that
it.
Whereas 2 of us working on it, normally he does it by himself, so it probably moved a little faster, not much, but a little.
Yeah, and it's not so much that the setup is time-consuming, but it takes you away from this. Because I was telling you, sometimes I'm setting up a YouTube video, and I get so frustrated with the production setup that it comes off on camera. Mm-hmm. I'm just already pissed off. I don't know what I'm talking about. Like,
why'd you click my channel? Did I just pop us? Oh, jeez.
Yes. Do you think that IKEA shelf with all those bins could be like emptied in half, emptied in like 75%? What do you think?
Honestly, because of the shuffle to get what I need, I could probably go down to like 1 bin.
Really?
I'm at that point where I just kept getting stuff, putting it here, putting it there. It was very useful when I got it because I needed it, right? So that's how I justify it. So no, but then with time, you realize that you've outgrown it.
Yeah.
Everything I've purchased came into use for me for a window.
Yeah, yeah.
And as you learn more about the thing about photography is you don't know everything. You'll never know everything. I'm sure Zach Arias, I'm sure, you know, Joel McNally.
Is that the right name?
I'm not good with
you. I thought you were going to say Ron Burgundy.
Ron Burgundy's like, hello, San Francisco. No, but I'm sure every single photographer in the world today is learning something every day, because technology is advancing at the point where you have to learn something or you're falling back.
Yeah, yeah.
So when I got the 603s, I rocked those for about a year plus, and they were the greatest things ever. They changed everything for me. And then next thing I knew, I got the 622s. And then from there...
Yeah, and by the way, that jump for me happened because I wanted to change my flash powers from the camera. And so the 603s were so manual, you had to walk over to your flash. And then my flashes were all inside some kind of umbrella with
super,
a cover.
Yeah,
soft deep, box, deep. Yeah. Actually, before changing powers, I went from super dumb to having more than one group, and then being able to turn some flashes on, turn off.
Turning on TTL if you needed it.
And then, yeah, exactly. And then all of a sudden you're like, these triggers don't work with that. What are the next triggers? And then your drawer fills up.
Exactly. Same thing with my flashes. I went from the simple Minolta old-fashioned crank flash.
Out of Vivitar. It was like...
They're cousins.
Yeah.
They're related. So, I mean, that was the greatest flash ever at the time. And for someone else right now starting, it's going to be the greatest flash ever
you know what?
For a time.
Think about this. Think about this. You thinking?
I'm thinking.
Think. It was a simpler time.
It was a simpler time.
Think if you just had a 35mm lens and that old Vivitar... with a young-yo, and you were just out. You know, it's like, it's a simpler time.
That's what I'm saying.
You know, and that's happening too, is with the flashpoint system and the Godox and the triggers and the two systems and the TTL and the high-speed sync. Sometimes it's like, dang, you know, it's a lot of noise.
But if you're that guy brand new, saying to yourself, I want to figure out how to improve my lighting. He watches a video. They say, go off-camera flash.
Manny Ortiz, yo.
How do I get into off-camera flash?
Manny Ortiz, yo.
I buy something on eBay to start me out.
Totally.
You know, or I go to Amazon, whatever. But either way, you know, these things that we have cluttering space have to be moved. So we're going to sell some of them. Where would you start donating it, though?
Well, I think like schools maybe that have programs for photography, if they could take a bunch of dumb flashes that are old and use those.
And that's what I think. I think if you go to a school that's in a, you know, an environment where funds aren't readily available to them to donate or create these little clubs, if you go in there and drop off four triggers, you drop off two old flashes, and you tell them, this is the beginning of your photo club. Run with it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, show that person at the school where they can buy the stuff really cheap so that they're not going to break their budget to create this program. But I think it's very important to get cameras into the hands of the youth today with the way cell phones are going.
Yeah.
I mean, are we going to be shooting weddings on cell phones professionally in about 7 years?
I don't know, maybe.
I mean, with these fake bokeh stuff and they get more and more realistic, it's like...
I'm not going to say anything because remember the iPhone just turned... The iPhones are turned like 10 recently,
10,
you know, so
a year ago,
it's come so long, you know, so far. So I'm not going to say, I mean, I just watched Back to the Future Part 2. That stuff is incredible. that shark came out of nowhere. I think the moral is it will free up your mind as well. A minimalist. I don't want to go minimalist. You know, I don't want to be like these YouTubers that have like one little keyboard on the 8-foot desk with like lights coming up. That's so unrealistic.
Now everyone knows. Everyone knows Marquez is like the most awesome tech YouTuber out there, right? But his OCD about cleanness, it wouldn't work in my world. I am so opposite of crispy and clean.
Yeah.
You know, those are his catchphrases. I love him. But my desk is if it's not crispy, it must be soggy.
Yeah.
You know, I am soggy and messy. That's just how I work. I clean up my stuff before I shoot a video. I clean up stuff when I have people coming over. But my environment is chaos.
I'm a dumper. I don't know if you're a dumper. Are you a dumper?
I'm a dumper. I get yelled at for dumping.
Yeah, I dump and I drop things. Like, here, I'll show you. Here's how. Fresh from last night.
Dump,
you know, I didn't take apart my camera from an event. I just came up here and dumped it, you know. And everything is still in the bags and they're dumped on the floor. And part of my... Part of my planning for the office is to have spaces where I can dump and have the place still look good. Like, for example, this can go in spaces under the...
Right, a little slide under type of thing. Put it away, but you can still get to it.
Little cubbies that are like temporarily... Remember Burger King when we used to work? They had like countertops, but then there were shelving.
Yes.
It was shelving underneath. So I'm thinking shelving underneath where I could dump stuff but still have clear mind. I don't know. Is that a solution or is that
just hiding
the
problem? Can we be honest with each other though?
What?
How long will that shelving, that system work for you?
That's what I'm thinking.
Because my thing is I bought these cubbyhole things in my place to fix my mess problem, which then they became a mess within themselves. So just know who you are.
Forget everything we said. All right, Japanese lady, thank you for trying. You can go now. But see, let me show you my drawer. All right, come here, lady. See this right here? Look at this.
I need one of these for no reason whatsoever.
So look, I have a blue gel, random. I have the carton for crazy glue.
Garbage.
I've got a black stamp, a bag of rubber bands.
Ooh,
do I need a bag in a bag?
Yes, you need a bag in a bag of rubber bands. And rubber bands random.
All right, this is good. This is supposed to be my office stuff. Suguru. This notebook is full already. You know, and that's... Oh, look. I've got... one piece of gum.
Add that to the collection.
So that's how it goes. Know who you are is today's story.
So it took you 15 minutes to tell you, but the bottom line is, if you're capable,
fooled you.
If you're capable of doing something like that and changing your life, that's great. Organize, sell, get rid of. That's bottom line. That's still true. Organize, dispose, or sell. That part's still true. The other stuff about organization and trying to keep it neat.
Yeah, good luck.
Just know who you are. You know, if you don't live in that kind of world, then you don't live in that kind of world. Thank you for joining us, though, because we are Slabos El Cool. I make up words like it's business.
Do you know what the black foamy thing is?
I'm assuming it's camera related and not what my brain is thinking.
Let's think of things that... Oh, you were thinking something nasty?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, Omar, tell me about this black foamy thing.
All right, so I wanted to tell you about this black foamy thing. You were talking about how photographers are always learning and trying to move on. I'm always trying to make my craft better, like tweak it little by little so it gets better each time. So I didn't know this until I saw this cool video, and we'll link it up below. Anyway, the black foamy thing is invented by or popularized by Neil Van...
Vandernick?
Yeah, God, he's got a hard name.
We apologize. We'll just put it right here. Right
Ben
over my
Kirk,
head.
Kirk
right, across my
head. He's from New Jersey, by the way. He's in our area, and he shoots around here.
Should we apologize?
Anyway, I found out that, you know, we always try to bounce our flash everywhere. Mm-hmm. And so let me explain with the black foamy thing. It's basically just this thing that's foam, and it's black, and it's a thing.
Thingy, nice.
And what you do is you get foam craft, like yo, check it out. Foam craft.
Is that velvet?
Hey, we haven't done some asthma in a while. Oh, the black foamy things.
Sorry.
It's just craft foam like this, which you could buy, you know, at your local Michaels or whatever craft store.
Not sponsored.
Not sponsored by. We could be. Call us.
Every day. We're waiting.
And the way it works is this way, is before using the black foamy thing is just a piece of foam that blocks forward moving speed light flash. And so what was happening was we try to bounce light up to make it softer, which works, but what we forget is there's junky light that's falling forward.
Leak off,
bro. It's leaky.
It's like it's peeing on your people.
It's peeing on your subjects. So I started blocking the light that shoots forward. And so the black foamy thing works best if you are bouncing light to the side. You know, so if you're using a white wall, you will bounce off to the side. And then none of that leak off comes off and you don't get any weird little... I was getting like two kinds of weird lights. Tested it, loved it. Now I always shoot with a black foamy thing and the flash bender.
I was going to ask you, how does the Rogue flash bender work with that foamy thing? It does hit it off the top, right? Obviously the light...
Basically, one of the negatives is that it gives, when you use it with the flash bender, you do get a little bit more kind of, you get soft light coming off the flash bender instead of this forward junk, but it's more spotlightish. So what seems to happen is that since this is coming out almost like a snoot instead of like a splashing everywhere, you get softer light, but it's concentrated more in the middle. So in post, you got to be careful. Yeah. Okay. But black foamy thing, I recommend if you are doing event photography to sort of shield that junky pea light.
If you have the right walls around you, so you can't use this everywhere. So if you have a completely black ceiling, or if your walls are not a nice shade of white or beige or something, even beige would be scary. But anything that's not going to be perfect to bounce off of, you don't want to use that, because then you're definitely going to lose everything.
Yeah, for sure.
You're going to have nothing bouncing off the ceiling, and you're going to have no pee on, which in this case could have been helpful.
Yeah, which is why...
You still gel, though.
We gelled, yeah, for sure. This is gelled. Why the flash bender becomes your wall. It's like all you have. The light that fills up in here goes forward. And people use domes and mag mods and all this stuff. They all, if one claims to be better than the next and the next.
You have to find what works for you.
You have to find one what works for you. This is huge for some people. And two, they all pretty much suck.
Yeah. I mean, they make a better than nothing, but... You can substitute all of them, and they're still going to be the equal level of garbage. You know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's better than nothing. Again, and I love the Rogue Flashbender system.
Yeah, for sure. The benefit the Rogue Flashbender has over all those other mother domes, yo, which is why the Flashbender wins, is you can pull it off if you need in a second, right?
Right.
You can flag, but the best is if you need to throw light forward. Like there's no ceiling up above, you know, you can actually shoot light more forward, or you can feather that light off. You have more control over the light.
You are the master of your own light. Thank you, Rogue.
Yeah, take that, MagMod.
But no.
Sponsored by MagMod.
Ding.
Ding.
Davis says, check, son. Negative
oh my God.
Balance.
Worst commercial ever.
I think we have to pay them.
Oh my God. Is that enough for an episode?
No, 7 minutes.
Let's just end it there, man. That was great.
All right. Thanks for coming.
Because I got to edit this, yo.
No problem. So, everyone, again, thanks for coming through.
Check your stuff.
If you have friends that are into photography and might want to listen to two crazy old photographers talk about anything that they feel like talking about, or just dying about the flu on the microphone, feel free to share our stuff with people. I mean, we've had an amazing growth in the last few months, but that doesn't mean we want to see that stop. So you keep us growing. And we keep on showing. Yeah, son.
Yeah.
all everyone unsubscribed right now.
Yeah. How do we get 10 subscribers? We're down to 10. No one ever goes backwards.
Anyway, thanks for stopping by.
We'll see
we
love you
next
guys.
Time.
All right. Cheers. Cha-ching.